Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members content? Okay, thank you. So our next item of business this morning is an evidence session on the Scottish Government's 2023-24 budget. The budget was published on the 15th of December 2022. The Stage 1 debate on the budget bill is expected to take place in the next few weeks. Today's evidence session is about those areas in the budget that come within the committee's remit. And I welcome John Swinney, Deputy First Minister, who's joined by Colin Cook, Director of Economic Development, Aidan Greasewood, Interim Director, Economic Strategy, Kathleen Swift, Head of Economic Directorate Finance Unit, and also Richard Rollison, Director of International Trade and Investment. As always, if members and witnesses can keep their contributions as concise as possible, that would be helpful. And I invite the Deputy First Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I welcome this opportunity to give evidence on the Scottish Government's draft budget for 23-24 and also on the delivery plans for the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. And if it is acceptable, Convener, I'll just make opening remarks that will cover both of those areas, if that would be acceptable. And both the National Strategy and the budget support our long-term aims and ambitions for transformation to a stronger, fairer, greener economy. And in the short term, while our levers are limited, also provide immediate support for our businesses through the current cost crisis. This continues to present a significant challenge. The latest inflation figures published just this morning, covering December 2022, show that inflation remains very high at 10.5%. When facing some of the most turbulent economic and financial conditions that most people can remember, the Scottish Government has had the difficult task of providing as much support as possible when our budget is lower in real terms than in 2021. That means having to make difficult choices in the forthcoming financial year. We have chosen to concentrate our efforts to eradicate child poverty, to provide sustainable public services and to transform the economy to deliver a just transition to net zero. The National Strategy provides the right foundations upon which we can transform our economy and help secure better outcomes as we emerge from these difficult conditions. In setting the budget and in the development of the NSET delivery plans, we have firmly prioritised the actions that will give us maximum return on our strategic objectives. In the coming financial year, we're bringing forward measures to boost entrepreneurship and productivity across sectors and regions, as well as investment in our infrastructure. We are committed to funding the transition to net zero, not only to meet our climate change targets, but because this transition will help us realise our long-term economic ambitions, bringing investment, jobs and growth. The skills and employability aspects of NSET are also being supported so that more people can access more job opportunities both now and in the future, helping some of the most vulnerable in our society into employment and improving their well-being. We have consulted with the public, private and third sectors throughout the development of NSET and we will continue to work in partnership with them as we push forward with delivery. I appreciate the committee's pre-budget scrutiny and report, and as well as being given the opportunity to respond, I look forward to discussing some of these points with the committee this morning.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. You referred to the letter you received from the committee and the areas that we had considered in our budget considerations. And, you know, notwithstanding the significant economic challenges that Scotland is facing due to a number of external factors, there have been pressures on the budget that have led to some difficult decisions have been made. One was about the reduction in spending for employability services. The Fraser Valander published a report, an analysis into the decision that had been made, and evidence that the committee heard from businesses, you know, did talk about the tightness in the labour market and the value there is in bringing people who are furthest away from the labour market into employment. If you can maybe talk through, because we've had a number of correspondence from, I mean, I asked the First Minister about it, is it conveners group? We've had letters from Richard Lockhead, I think from yourself, about the cuts. So the money, the 53 million, was money that hadn't been spent, because it looks a bit like we're being told there's nothing to worry about here, but there has been a reduction in an area. So was it money that hadn't been committed? Is that why the decision was taken in this area?
Essentially, if you'll forgive me, Convener, I fear this is going to be a long answer, but I'll try to make it as quick as I can. But essentially, as the financial year has progressed, the scale of pressure on our budget has become more and more apparent through really two factors. The additional resources we've had to find for public sector pay, we'd budgeted on 2% for public sector pay, we're clearly paying more than that to address the legitimate claims of employees. And secondly, the effect of inflation, for which we've had no, there's been no change in the resources available to the budget. So I've had to take some pretty difficult decisions to balance the budget. And as I explained to the Finance Committee last Tuesday, I'm still not in a position to be confident that I can balance the resource budget this year. And the scale of financial pressure I'm still wrestling with, and this is now mid-January, is between £200 and £500 million that I need to save before I can balance the budget this year. In trying to get to that position, I had to make reductions in planned expenditure. And one of those reductions, as you correctly point out, Convener, was in employability programmes. Now, essentially what I did was I removed an increase in budget that was projected. So I didn't take away any spend that was being delivered. What I didn't put in place was an increase that was planned. Now, the opportunity cost of that, Convener, which I think is the point that you're driving at, is a fair point to raise, because obviously the more we can spend on employability, the more we can try to erode the levels of economic inactivity within our society, because the programmes we work on and we fund, as distinct from the programmes funded by the Department for Work and Pensions, are essentially on that group of individuals who are furthest from the labour market, who will require much wider and more holistic support to get them back into employment. Now, the reason why I felt so, the opportunity, so I accept that the opportunity cost is that we perhaps could have put in place programmes that would have provided opportunities for more people to re-enter the labour market. I think there's two factors that I would set out to reassure the committee on its the understandable concerns that you put to me, Convener. One is that we have seen in the employment data yesterday a fall in economic inactivity in Scotland of about nearly 1% in the year. Now, that's quite a substantial reduction in economic inactivity levels, given the fact that many people in that category face significant challenges, and it's a much higher reduction in economic inactivity than in the rest of the United Kingdom. And the second point is that when I took that decision, and still today, there remains capacity in our existing employability programmes to take on new individuals. So if an individual wanted to re-enter the labour market and required support, there would still be capacity in our employability programmes to do that. And finally, for completeness, Convener, the budget does envisage an increase in employability support in the next financial year. So although I've had to take a short-term decision to remove planned expenditure to help me to balance the budget, we are increasing the resources available for employability support in the forthcoming financial year.
That's helpful to know. How much would that increase be? Would it compensate for the 53?
Do you no, have an, no, it won't. It will be.
So is the 53? Is it 68 minus 53?
It's about. It's an increase of about £11 million.
So it's not
of the scale that was originally envisioned.
Because when you talked about NSET, you know, you stressed the importance of helping the vulnerable into employment as being part of the 10-year strategy. So while I accept there is a net gain to the employability budget of £11 million once we had subtracted 53, would there be an intention in future years to put increased investment into this area? Because you've recognised there's an opportunity loss here. So, you know, there will be activity that was planned, or there was activity that was seen as being important that now won't take place because of the reduction in the original increase.
The question really relates to what is the necessary capacity we need to have available to, in the employability budgets to support the return of people to the labour market. And we projected a significant increase in those budgets for this current year. We've not been able to fulfil that because of the issues that I've raised, but we would be looking to support that activity as much as we can do, recognising the effectiveness of such expenditure. So it will be something that I monitor very carefully. I would also give the assurance that one of the issues I've looked at in taking this decision was the capacity of programmes to deliver support to individuals. So there's almost a demand-led element of these programmes. So if we see during the course of the financial year that demand for programmes is rising and we are finding it difficult to meet the demand within the labour market, then obviously I would look to address that issue during the financial year, mm-hmm. if it was possible to do so.
Yeah, that's helpful. The committee is about to undertake a short inquiry into the employment disability gap, so that will help inform our discussions.
And obviously the committee's deliberations on that question would be helpful for the government to understand, because you know, we recognise, you know, if we look at the data on the labour market, which was published yesterday, we find ourselves in the position with employment at a record high, unemployment sitting very low at 3.3%. So despite the fact that we're experiencing enormous volatility in economic conditions, employment remains very high, unemployment remains very low. Now, obviously, there's a couple of observations about that, convener. One is that that might not be the case on a sustained basis because there's obviously a lot of economic turbulence coming our way. But secondly, we have to be mindful of the importance that NSET attaches to increasing the value of employment, and that's a major consideration of the approach to employment support and employability and economic development that we have within our wider programme.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to bring in members who are initially focusing on the letter and the areas that we wrote to the Cabinet Secretary about. So, Gordon, would you like to come in first? Gordon MacDonald, I think you're asking on
the business rate. Yeah, okay, thanks very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wanted to ask you about the pressures on businesses, and you know, you've talked about inflation at 10.5%. We've got high energy costs. We've got labour costs that are flowing out of that because of that. So what support is the government put in place in the areas where it has responsibility to businesses, given that businesses are looking for some form of certainty so that they can plan for the recession that's being suggested?
There's a number of areas where the government is trying within our resources and areas of responsibility to provide that support. The first area I would highlight is obviously the approach that we're taking on non-domestic rates, where the principal request of 16 business organisations was for the rates poundage to be frozen. So normally there would be an expectation that would increase in line with inflation. I took a decision to freeze the business rate, but obviously that does not come without cost to the government. So the estimated cost of that was £308 million. So the freezing of the business rate means that businesses in Scotland have the lowest business rates poundage in the United Kingdom, and they also don't have to face an inflation increase. Secondly, recognising the implications of the revaluation that has taken place, we've put in place some transitional relief for businesses. And then obviously, thirdly, the small business bonus scheme is designed to provide support to companies in sustaining their operations. Now, I'm not for a moment going to suggest that all of that is going to address the issues. Obviously, we've engaged in dialogue with the United Kingdom government on the successor energy package that the UK government is bringing forward, and We've obviously contributed our thinking to that. These are decisions for the United Kingdom government, and I obviously welcome the fact that there is some ongoing support, but I think we're all conscious that, that there still remain significant challenges for business as a consequence of these issues. In addition to some of those measures, you know, other investments the government makes, whether it's in the support that we put in place for skills training, which is obviously important, and particularly in the area of apprenticeships, to try to support, to link with the points the convener has rightly raised with me about the labour market, and then some of the other investments that are made around trying to ensure that colleges, for example, are adapting their provision to meet the challenges that are prevalent within the labour market, and also the shift that has to be made within the labour market to support the net zero ambitions. I'm thinking particularly here about the need to shift activity to support the development of renewables and the significant opportunities that arise out of Scotland. So those are just some of the measures that the government is able to take forward, but I would say that we remain very much open to listening to the views of the business community. That's why we set up the Business Regulation Task Force, which was jointly chaired by my colleague Ivan McKee and the COSLA Enterprise Spokesperson, Councillor McGregor. And the purpose of the Business Regulation Task Force is to listen carefully to business, and where there are issues in the regulated environment that are causing obstacles and there's no good reason for them to be there, we try to address that as swiftly as we possibly can do.
You touched upon small business bonus scheme. When that was introduced in 2008, there was roughly 60,000 premises that benefited from it. It's now over 100,000. Can you say how much that's actually helping to businesses in Scotland in terms of financial terms?
Well, as Mr. McDonald correctly identifies, that there are more businesses benefiting from the small business bonus scheme than when we set out on this particular scheme. I should also point out that we've put in place further incentives in the non-domestic rate scheme for companies involved in renewables to try to tailor the relief package to encourage more development in that respect. So the number of properties that will benefit from business rates will, you know, I would expect to be around about 100,000, and we've also got some transitional relief available for small companies in that respect.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Just in relation to small business bonus scheme, the Fraser of Allender carried out an inquiry into the small business bonus scheme at the request of the Scottish Government, and I think it was Tom Arthur, who's the Minister responsible, who's answered a few questions in Parliament. I was just wondering if there's an update on the Government's consideration of the work from Fraser of Allender and what steps would be taken next in relation to that.
Well, obviously, we these are commitments which I suppose they might have the hallmark of being part of the fabric of our proposition that we make available, but we obviously have to take an active choice to maintain schemes of this type. So the government has considered the issues raised in this area of policy and determined that our small business community continues to require that degree of support. We've tried to address some of the issues by the design of the transitional relief scheme that's available, and also to ensure that we are constantly monitoring the continued appropriateness of the companies that are involved in the small business bonus scheme, so that we're monitoring and assessing the appropriate levels at which business rates relief should be set, and some of the thinking from the Fraser of Allender Institute helps us in that respect.
Okay, thank you. Colin Smith, did you want a supplementary on business? Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Convener. Just a bit, very briefly on the business rates, Deputy First Minister. Last year, the approach to reliefs was recognised as being less generous than in England and Wales. And this year, I think, to quote the Fraser of Alistair Institute in their budget response, Johnson has taken an even more hardline approach, and there's no additional reliefs applied to the hospitality and retail sector, as is the case of south of the border. Now, given the very real pressures on those sectors, which I think the committee highlighted, why was that choice made? I appreciate that there's a freeze in the multiplier and relief for renewables, but why no specific relief for hospitality and retail, given the pressures they're under?
I think it's important to, when we look at this area, and I understand the comparison that Mr. Smith puts to me, that we're not looking at directly comparable schemes as to what Scotland offers in relation to business rates and what is habitually offered in England. So we've got two different propositions. The small business bonus scheme is a much more generous scheme in Scotland than comparable schemes south of the border. And of course, any measures that we take are come at a cost. So the overall estimated cost of the business rates measures that we are taking is an estimated £744 million. So there is a substantial investment being made in supporting business. Now, one of the factors that bore heavily in my consideration of what was the right thing to do was the representations from business organisations asking us to freeze the poundage, which of course gives that comprehensive approach right across the business sectors. And I was pleased to be able to do that. And I think the second relevant factor is that our estimate is that about half of the properties in the retail, hospitality and leisure sectors will be eligible for 100% small business bonus relief in 23-24. So there is a substantial contribution being made to alleviate the issues and the challenges that that sector will face.
Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Good morning. Thank you for attending today. I wanted to follow up on a deeply held interest of mine around the role of women and their contribution and their contribution to entrepreneurialism and so on. Our pre-budget calls mentioned disaggregation of data and progress in the Women's Business Centre, and thank you for the replies from the Scottish Government. The ironic thing was, in our pre-budget letter from last year, we also asked about disaggregation of data. So I've got three simple questions today. And firstly, I would say that I recognise the worthwhile efforts that are going on from the Scottish Government to promote this area, and we all look with interest and anticipation to Anna Stewart's review. So setting that aside, my simple three asks today to start to move from review into getting under the skin of what is a structural issue is, can the Scottish Government, and can you play your part in ensuring all data collected by the Scottish Government is routinely disaggregated by gender as a matter of routine?
I think generally that would be the case, but obviously if there's specific data sets that Michelle Thompson has in mind, then I would be very happy to look at where we could enhance that. But generally, I think we do try to look at all of these issues through the prism of gender. And I think the particular point that Michelle Thompson puts to me about entrepreneurship is a particularly relevant question, because I think the data that I've certainly seen shows a position where we've got a deteriorating position in relation to women's involvement in entrepreneurship, hence the work that Anna Stewart is taking forward for the government.
So just finishing off on that first question, I don't know the entirety of data sets, so it's hard for me to say this is what's missing. And that perhaps talks to the problem, because if we don't collect the data routinely, we won't be able to then start to create the complex patterns. So I suppose in principle, what I'm asking is, as a minimum, will you take away today to ensure that, to undertake a review of where data is disaggregated by gender and critically where it isn't, and then perhaps be prepared to return with a compelling reason why it shouldn't be?
Well, I think let me just place on record that, you know, we do know already from data that the number of women-led SME employers in Scotland has reduced from 20% in 2015 to 14% in 2019. So that's an issue of real concern to us, which has led to the prompting of the review by Anna Stewart. We also know from other data that females in Scotland are around half as likely to be early-stage entrepreneurs as males. So the data already tells us that, hence the action that we are taking. So I wouldn't want the committee to feel that we don't have the data to prompt the review and the action that we need to take, because I think that data exists and I've placed it on the public record today. I'm certainly very happy to take away the questions on data and to respond to the committee. Some of these issues may, of course, be part of what Anna Stewart recommends, so I'm speculating on that. But I think it would be sensible for me to wait to see what Anna Stewart produces and then perhaps reflect on the issues that Michelle Thompson is putting to me within the context of our response to Anna Stewart.
And I agree, we all wait with great interest and anticipation. I'm very hopeful, having had Mark Logan here last week. My follow-on question is, are you able to make it compulsory for any and all agencies receiving any money from the Scottish Government as part of their Fair Work agenda, or indeed any other business initiatives, to routinely collect and disaggregate by gender? Because I can tell you categorically that, having asked this question a number of times in this committee, they do not routinely do that, which I actually find quite shocking. So are you able...
On what type of questions?
There's two examples that jump out at me. A question about any research being done by a business agency. I asked a question, do you routinely disaggregate the data so you can understand the breakdown by gender? And the question answer came back, no, we don't. And also another agency to do with commerce and development, we were asked if they routinely did that. And I would expect that as a minimum. And I suppose what I'm asking is, regardless of Anna Stewart's review, is the Scottish Government, and are you able to commit today that you agree, as a minimum, any agency receiving money from the Scottish Government should routinely gather and disaggregate this data?
Yeah, I think that's an entirely reasonable proposition, but I'll take it away and look at it in detail.
I've got one final last question around the same theme. Now, you might not be able to answer this just now, but I would like you to be able to give consideration and perhaps even respond to the committee to setting targets to increase participation of women, particularly with regard to entrepreneurialism, and give firm consideration and perhaps come back and say why you can't do it, to make any funding conditional on meeting those targets?
On the first part of that, I would be very surprised if we don't end up in such a position as a consequence of what Anna Stewart recommends to us. So, I'm just simply trying to get my process correct, that we've commissioned this review and we'll hear from it. But I'd be absolutely staggered if we're not in a position where we are taking specific measures to enhance the participation of women in entrepreneurialism as a consequence of Anna's review. So I think that's highly likely. And but regardless of what the review produces, the government is committed to taking such actions. That's why we've commissioned Anna Stewart to do the work that she's undertaking. The second point of conditionality is is a much wider question, because what that, you know, if I just play that back, what that essentially means is that we would only fund Scottish Enterprise in the future if they met particular targets for particular aspects of women's participation in entrepreneurialism. Now, there's nothing wrong with that as an idea, but I think it's got wider implications about the future sustainability of organisations like Scottish Enterprise. We've not used the model of conditional funding for public sector agencies. I'm not saying there's not an argument for it. It's a perfectly legitimate argument for it. Indeed, it might be a way of prompting the type of performance outcomes that we want to get. So I'm not dismissing it. I'm simply saying it would require very wide consideration about what is the nature and of public expenditure and how do we go about that. And I think Parliament would have some pretty broad views about that that question.
I completely agree. I completely agree that it's complex. I'd be careful what you wish for, particularly where you have early start industries. But I suppose as an approach to look at that with an open mind and to stress that agencies will have to do that as well as a way of turning the dial, because Mark Logan, who was in front of us last week, and this is my last comment, was very clear that the initiatives that are underway are good in of themselves, but what he was emphasising and what drives me is to start to plant the trees that will affect structural change. And unless we ask these hard questions and start to look much more firmly at conditionality, where in those areas where we can be clear or at least make a good assessment of the outcomes, we will carry on producing worthy reviews. And I agree they're worthwhile, but it won't shift the dial.
I think if I highlight the experience that we have about one of the points that Mark Logan made to the committee was about the health of early stage entrepreneurial activity within Scotland today. Now, I attribute that to seeds that were planted pretty close to 10 years ago when I took a decision to invest in Scottish Edge, which has created a very vibrant entrepreneurial community. There's a lot of risk involved in it, a lot of risk. And, you know, when I was being advised on the considerations I had to have in supporting such a scheme, I was properly advised of the degree of risk that would be involved because of the likelihood that there would be business failures and that there would be reputational risk to government as a consequence of business failures. But in my view, that was a risk worth taking because what has it done over all these years? It's now created exactly what Mark Logan said to the committee, which was not always the case, because there was, go back 10 years before that, and there was substantial concern about early stage entrepreneurial activity within Scotland. I think we've largely arrested that problem and that we have resolved it because of appropriate decisions taken, must be about 8-9 years ago, I think. And we need to, the challenges that we now need to focus on, which many of our other measures are supporting, particularly around the Scottish National Investment Bank, are around about the question of scaling up business activity, where we have the necessary investment capital to enable new start businesses in Scotland to flourish, to become much more significant contributors to the economy.
Okay, thank you.
Before I bring Graham Simpson, can I just ask a quick question about our budget letter? We asked about the Women's Business Centre, which there's a commitment to. The response from the government doesn't really provide much confidence that this is still a policy area. It seems conditional on Anna Stewart's review, so I'm just looking for, do we still have a commitment to a Women's Business Centre and the £50 million that's been committed to develop it?
We do have a commitment we have a continuing commitment to the Women's Business Centre. But I think for completeness, the government believes that we should look at that, how we take that forward in the light of the review that we received from Anna Stewart. In relation to financial issues, one of the points I placed on the record when I set out the budget statement to Parliament is that given the financial challenges that we face, there may well be some policy commitments that take us longer to deliver than we ordinarily would have wanted to, quite simply because of the financial pressures due to higher inflation with which we are wrestling.
It might be helpful if the Cabinet Secretary was able... The question was how the £50 million will be spent this year and how it's, if we maybe get a note following the meeting about that, that would be helpful. Graham Simpson to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks. I just want to follow up on that last question, actually, because I'm a little bit confused by your answer. So is there going to be a Women's Business Centre or not?
Well, we remain committed to the policy concept of a Women's Business Centre, but I think for completeness... What I'm saying to the committee is it would be best to consider how we take that forward in the light of receiving Anna Stewart's review.
Okay, then we'll leave that. You mentioned the Scottish National Investment Bank, and I will ask you about that. But before I get to that, I just want to ask you about the line in your budget in relation to Ferguson Marine. It had £47 million in 21-22, 35.9 in 22-23, and that goes up to 60.9 million in 23-24. So, I mean, you know, at times when you look at the money given to the yard, it's almost like watching an edition of Anton Deck's Limitless Win. There doesn't seem to be any kind of cap on it. So can you guarantee that that's 60.9 allocated in 23-24 is it, or is there going to be any more?
Yeah, I certainly hope that that is it, yes.
That's not a commitment.
Well, I'm giving the committee, I'm required to give the committee honest answers, and I hope that that is the last that we have to contribute for the construction of 801 and 802.
I mean, do you have a maximum in mind that you're prepared to put into it?
Let me be absolutely crystal clear about this. That's what I hope. That's what we've been... The assessment from the yard of what they require is what I've provided for, both in the additional commitment of around about £15 million that I've allocated in this current financial year and the sum that's provided for in the budget for 23-24. So I'm responding to the plans put to me by the yard, and they are obviously, you know, the government looks very carefully and scrutinises those propositions put to us. So I hope that is the last of the contributions we have to make.
Okay, so I'll ask you about the Scottish National Investment Bank, because that's also receiving quite an increase. A real terms increase in funding. And I wonder if you could just tell us, you know, what's that based on? Are you expecting them to deliver anything particular? Have they come forward with particular projects that whetted your appetite, which has prompted you to give this extra funding?
Well, the government... gave a commitment that we would invest over a 10-year period about £2 billion in the Scottish National Investment Bank to support investment in ventures within the Scottish economy that would generate significant economic impact and financial return. So what the budget essentially provides for is the building up of that investment, and of course as we build up that investment in the Scottish National Investment Bank, the bank takes its decisions on the investments that it makes. So, you know, for example, just in early December the bank announced an investment in a company called North Star, providing £50 million in a £95 million capital expenditure facility to allow the business to expand its fleet of service operation vessels, which are expected to support offshore wind projects in Scotland. So that's a very good example, I think, of the bank using the resources. The bank considers all the risk issues of investment, because as the committee will appreciate, there's no guarantees about these investments that are made. That's what our organisations like the Scottish National Investment Bank have got to assess. They consider that there is a long-term business opportunity there for which there will be a return for that investment if the government provides that investment at this stage. If the bank provides the investment at this stage. So there'll be other ventures of that type where the bank will make an assessment and draw down on the resources the government provides to them.
Okay. But when you have decided to give them a real terms increase. So what are you expecting in return for that real terms increase?
I'm expecting them to invest in companies that will deliver economic benefit and employment benefit to Scotland, that will generate financial returns to the bank so that we see a return on that investment which can then be utilised for future years' long-term patient investment.
Okay. I just wonder, and you can tell us or your officials can tell us, how those investments are monitored, because I was looking at one of the companies that the bank has invested in is a company called TravelNest, which was awarded $5.5 million last year. And just to explain, that helps property owners get their holiday rentals advertised on different sites like Airbnb and Booking.com and others. So it struck me that these companies might be able to fund that themselves. And when I was looking on the company's house about TravelNest, it appears to have a London address rather than Scotland. So I just wonder how it's monitored.
Well, the Scottish National Investment Bank will look at propositions that are designed to create economic and employment benefits within Scotland as a consequence of their activities. Now, they might not be uniquely concentrated in Scotland, because obviously companies are operating in a much wider context. The investment I highlighted there in North Star of £50 million, I suspect not all of that money will be spent uniquely in Scotland because of the nature of their activities. So there will be, but I would want to assure the committee that we are expecting the Scottish National Investment Bank to assess what is the business case for an investment, what the returns are likely to be, because there has to be returns out of this. But of course, there has to be, I think also, and certainly from my part, there's an acceptance. I would rather it wasn't the case, but I think I have to live in the real world, that some of these investments might not be successful. And that's all, it's always been part and parcel of the issues that we've wrestled with Scottish Enterprise, that some of the investments that Scottish Enterprise make, that some of them do really fantastically well, others don't do so well, and you have to take it in the round. And of course, I can remember an early conversation when I became a minister many years ago with the leadership of Scottish Enterprise, who wanted to just go through with me some of those challenges so that I was aware of the fact that I might have to defend a situation where an investment was not successful. And I accept the fact that, but the quid pro quo of that is that others must be successful to balance that out.
Yeah. It's the nature of investment. Some's going to work, some won't work out. And I'm not picking on that particular company. I just happened to look at that and it struck me that, they may not be particularly Scottish. I appreciate you want a return for our investment for Scotland. So I'm happy to leave it there.
Thank you. Jamie Harkle-Johnson, do you have a supplementary? I'll take that.
Yes, thanks very much. Just on the Scottish National Investment Bank, about a year ago, nearly 27th of January, Ailie McTaggart resigned as chief executive of the bank. Sarah Ruffhead has been the interim chief executive. Obviously, leadership in this organisation is key going forward. Can you give us an update where the bank is in terms of appointing a new chief executive?
The process has been taken forward. The bank has not been has got to a position in the last appointment consideration that a candidate emerged but then decided not to take the post, I think is the fairest way for me to capture that. Right. So Sarah Roughead continues to exercise chief executive responsibilities, obviously under the leadership of Willie Watt as the chair of the Scottish National Investment Bank, and the bank continues to make the progress that the government envisages, but the recruitment process it continues to be taken forward.
So can I ask very quickly, will that process have to restart then? If there was one candidate they didn't want to take it forward, regardless of what the reasons were?
It's a process that's been undertaken with recruitment consultants, so I think the short answer is yes.
Do you have any estimate on when there may be an appointment? Or?
I think we obviously would like to see that completed as soon as possible, but only with the right candidate.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Colin Behead to be followed by Fiona Heslop.
Thank you, Convener. Deputy First Minister, I'd like to continue with SNB just to get a better understanding on the funding side. SNB's been largely capitalised using financial transactions, which comes with certain restrictions to its use and has to be repaid over the long term. And in the back of my mind, I have a memory of 30 years or something for the repayment, but that may be historic, I don't know. Now, the bank said they're pursuing regulatory approval, which would enable them to manage third-party funds and increase their total capital resources. Have you had any considerations on allocating other forms of funding outside of financial transactions, which might give SNB a bit more flexibility?
Obviously, that option is available to me, but it's very much conditional on the wider pressures there are on the public finances and the programmes that we'd be expected to fund and support. Financial transactions, I think, actually are really quite appropriate as a mechanism for securing the investment in the Scottish National Investment Bank. I think the nature of financial transactions actually lend themselves to some of the issues that Mr. Simpson was raising with me about the fact that there has to be a recognition of the importance of return. So that, because of the nature of the repayment that is required on financial transactions. So I think that helps, that's appropriate as a mechanism at this time. But obviously there is a wider agenda about the regulatory strength of the Scottish National Investment Bank, and it's pursuing some of that those steps as part of developing the critical foundations of the bank in taking forward its investment activities.
Do you think that the nature of the capitalisation and the restrictions around that have impacted at all on the range of investments that SNB are able to do? I mean, I'm aware that although there's restrictions, they can still invest in private capital and all the rest, private equity and so on. But are there areas that SNB might have wanted to invest in that they're precluded from doing?
I don't think so. All SNB investments have got to be made on a commercial basis. So the bank is obviously in a position to make judgments about the ventures that merit its support and investment. And I think what the bank has, I think, successfully developed a very strong view on is the role that it can perform in being an enabler of other investment. So where the bank is able to invest in a particular proposition, it gives rise to potential investment from other parties, which therefore make ventures able to be better supported as a consequence. So I don't think the bank is operating under any particular constraints in being able to fulfil the remit that the government has set for the bank. But obviously, the bank is on a journey to develop its financial strength and its reputation. And I think the steps that have been taken are encouraging steps.
Earlier in the discussion, you mentioned that the Scottish Government wanted to put £2 billion over 10 years into SNB. Is it anticipated it will continue to use this form of capitalisation? And is there a confidence that this type of funding will continue to be available, given its nature?
That's the SNB is a long-term proposition for the government, and it's essentially, I think I would describe it as a long-term source of patient capital in the Scottish economy. So we envisage SNB being able to perform that role on a long-term basis. Obviously, it has to be a long-term commercial basis. So the issues of repayment are significant. The issues of returns are significant. And we are keen to ensure that over the long-term lifespan of the Scottish National Investment Bank, it continues to perform that role within the Scottish economy.
But coming back again to the nature of this type of capitalisation, is there any risk at all that funds from this source might not be available in the future? Or are we comfortable that that will not be the case?
I think the obviously the use of financial transactions is relevant to the current arrangements of the United Kingdom government and what plans they have. I think, actually, financial transactions is quite a good means. Sorry, the Scottish National Investment Bank route is actually quite an effective means for the government to utilise the financial transactions that are made available by the United Kingdom government, because financial transactions can't be readily used for many other aspects of public sector activity. So that arrangement actually is quite suitable. Now, obviously, I'm not privy to the future direction of United Kingdom government policy on these questions, but obviously the option remains available for the Scottish government to continue its investment alternatively through traditional capital investment in the Scottish National Investment Bank. I think for completeness in relation to the earlier points that I made in relation to the leveraging of investment, the bank has so far committed £366 million to 24 projects, but that has leveraged £526 million of other private sector investment. So I use that to illustrate the fact that, to provide some detail on the enabler point that I was making to the committee, that the bank is able, by its actions, to encourage and enable investment from other sources.
Thank you. Fiona Heslop, followed by Colmsma.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, Deputy First Minister. Tourism clearly is a sector that provides for sustainable economic growth right across Scotland. We also know that they're under particular pressure for lots of different reasons. But we also know that international spend by international visitors is one of the areas that can help it recover. We have previously, as a committee, expressed our view that support should be given to Visit Scotland, particularly for its international marketing. But bearing in mind that Visit Scotland's budget was £65 million in 21-22, is now proposed to be £49 million in 23-24, with a 2.7% reduction since last year. And the response from the Scottish Government to our request simply said that the Visit Scotland Board will fully consider scenarios that will enable them to successfully carry out their marketing activity in light of the Scottish budget. Doesn't really leave us with much comfort.
I would want to provide reassurance to the committee on this question, because I think one of the formidable strengths of Visit Scotland is the brand marketing activity that is taken forward of itself, but also what Visit Scotland has done, which has been a long-term ambition of government, and Sislop has played a significant role in enabling this to happen, is to actually gather together the marketing activity of a range of different organisations to be put together to essentially promote Scotland to a wider audience. I think Visit Scotland's record speaks for itself. They have an absolutely colossal reputation for marketing success and marketing recognition for many of their activities. And that's, I think, persuaded a number of different organisations to collaborate with Visit Scotland in pooling their resources to support international marketing activities. So I would reassure the committee on two fronts that Visit Scotland is able to undertake that domestic and international marketing activity, but secondly, they are able to do that in concert with a range of other organisations, and I would contend deliver much more effectiveness as a consequence. Now, I'd also, in putting the financial position of Visit Scotland into context, I would highlight the fact that there has been a strategic shift in the activity of Visit Scotland in recent years, much more in the direction of digital marketing. So the type of the model in the past was, and I don't mean this disrespectfully, but in some respects was a bit of a bricks and mortar model of the distribution of tourism and marketing information around the country. Now it's a much more digital model, and that can deliver much greater value for the public expenditure that's made.
Yeah, I might politely point out, 31st Minister, that was happening in 21-22. Indeed, that shift probably took place about 5 years ago. But I also agree that they're very effective in their marketing spend. Can I now move on to another area, and that's in relation to the need for Scotland to improve its productivity rates. It's great to see that that gap has been closed with the UK, but also recruitment and retention is a key issue, particularly in the current labour market. The programme for government had support for a four-day weekend, indeed funding for that. Perhaps you might want to reflect on where the policy and funding support is currently in this year, but also what your view is about that going forward, because we're about to see the results of the UK-wide pilot on this, which I think will be very positive, and I wouldn't want to see the Scottish Government falling behind on this agenda.
It's obviously a range of steps that we take to try to enhance productivity, and a lot of that is associated with, for example, the investment that we're making through the university research channel, which I think our universities have responded very positively over a number of years to our appeal to them to engage much more closely with the wider business community, to collaborate on business research, business and economic research. We're now seeing much stronger levels of collaboration and cooperation there, which I think will help us in relation to the partly answering the question on productivity. The wider investment that is made on skills is designed to do likewise. We obviously are operating in an incredibly tight labour market, which is putting additional pressures on the work that we are able to undertake to ensure that the needs of the business community are properly and fully reflected in the support that we're able to make available to ensure that businesses have access to the productive skills that they require. But I acknowledge that as an ongoing and significant challenge that we have to undertake. In relation to the work on the four-day week pilot, the budget lines on Fair Work provide that's where the activity is being undertaken. We'll be taking forward work in relation to the four-day week pilot as part of the 23-24 programme, and obviously that will be part of the wider agenda that the national strategy is focused on improving the productive capacity of the Scottish economy.
Okay. Thank you. And then finally, I want to move on to the issue of jobs and skills from the renewable energy sector. Yesterday in the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee session on the budget, the Cabinet Secretary for Michael Matheson was talking about the opportunities there, and specifically I questioned him on hydrogen. But what he also said was that the constraints in that sector were largely to do with, one, availability of labour, which we know there's real pressures on that, also on planning consents, and particularly on skills. And clearly, in a tight labour market, being able to transfer the skills that we have already is really important. Looking at the budget lines, however, and the pressures that were within this portfolio, clearly there's a emphasis by Scottish Enterprise Now, with hydrogen finally as one of the key sectors. And clearly there's a big focus on inward investment. My concern may be that if all the focus and funding is on inward investment, how can we ensure that the jobs and the manufacturing that we need is being supported for domestically initiated companies, not just inward investment? So perhaps if you could go through that area, that would be helpful.
Yeah, I think it's an absolutely fundamental, critical question for realising the opportunities that arise out of the offshore wind environment. I just would make one comment in relation to what Michael Matheson said yesterday to committee on planning consents, mm-hmm. and it's an issue that I recognise is of great significance to ensure that those involved in this activity are assured of an efficient and effective planning consent process to enable them to make decisions in a reasonable timescale about the investments that they make. It's important to address the substance of Ms. Hislop's question across a number of different areas in relation to the role of colleges around the skills and environment, and then the work of the Scottish National Investment Bank, to just take three particular elements of all of this. In relation to colleges, for example, I don't particularly want to live by anecdote to the committee this morning, but I did have a conversation with which warmed my heart with an entrepreneur who is involved in the offshore wind sector and wanted to develop a facility in Ayrshire. The particular skills were not available in Ayrshire, but there was a venture that enabled that he wished to pursue in that area. And he engaged in dialogue with Ayrshire College, and Ayrshire College engaged constructively with him, and a particular course was put in place to enable employees to be trained to meet his requirements in partnership with Ayrshire College. It was a splendid example of the college sector adapting its provision to meet the needs of a substantial economic opportunity in their locality. And that is what has to be reflected and mirrored in other parts of the country. And I'm very, again, Ms. Hislop knows the college sector intimately, and particularly in her own constituency experience in West Lothian. And she will know that is the outlook of colleges in wishing to seize these opportunities. The second area is in relation to skills development, where we obviously we've had some interruption to the apprenticeship progress that was being made prior to COVID. We were on course to have 30,000 modern apprentices. Skills Development Scotland is now ready and programmed to deliver the 25,000 modern apprenticeships that are envisaged in the budget programme, and obviously they are available to this sector. And thirdly, the Scottish National Investment Bank is obviously part of its mission is to invest in the net zero aspirations of the government. And I cited an example in my earlier response, I think, to Mr. Simpson about specific net zero related investments that have been made by the bank. So I think there is an opportunity. I think the committee should be assured that there is investment vehicles available to assist in that respect, to ensure that we can support and nurture the development of Scottish companies that can realise some of these manufacturing ambitions within Scotland.
And just finally, Michael Matheson made it quite clear that the planning constraints were being absolutely addressed by upskilling and expanding his areas of responsibility. And I was in terms of the staffing for that, and I hope as Finance Secretary you can support that. If you can maybe just address my question about Scottish Enterprises focus, and will that just, with SDI, will that just be on inward investment, or can you reassure us that that will also be about helping support the supply chain?
It will be about assisting the domestic supply chain. And just before Christmas, we had we drew together a range of interested parties, the government, Scottish Enterprise principally, with ministers. Michael Matheson and Ivan McKee were involved in those discussions to make sure that we have a very aligned approach to the development of the hydrogen proposition within Scotland. Mr McKee and I met with the board of Scottish Enterprise, it must have been just shortly before Christmas, actually, and we spent most of that discussion, which was at the annual strategy discussion of the Scottish Enterprise Board, talking significantly about hydrogen and the net zero opportunities. So Scottish Enterprise, with the leadership of Adrian Gillespie as Chief Executive, who has formidable experience in this area of activity, will be concentrating and focused on that proposition.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. Colin Smith, be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. It's obviously widely recognised we are in a recession, and you said earlier, Deputy First Minister, despite that fall in levels of labour inactivity, we could be at a labour market turning point. We're seeing falling vacancies and rising redundancies. Yet, in addition to the cut in funding to Visit Scotland, which Fiona Hislop highlighted, the Enterprise Agency will also see cuts in their overall funding. The Scottish Enterprise is a 4.9% real terms cut. Highlands and Islands, 5.5%. South of Scotland Enterprise, 9.7% cut, continuing a longer-term trend. So what were the reasons for those cuts, and what assessment have you made over how this will impact on support for businesses?
I think it's important that I just put a few things on the record about these numbers. For example, the Scottish Enterprise resource budget is projected to increase from £135 million to £141 million. The Hands and Islands budget is projected on resource to increase from £29.6 to £29.8 million. And the South of Scotland Enterprise budget projected to increase from £14.8 to £15.1 million. So all three of the enterprise agencies' budgets are projected to increase in cash terms. Now, I
the First Minister, their revenue budgets, you haven't mentioned the cuts in capital, so the overall level of reduction is quite clear in real terms and in cash terms for all three of those agencies, if you combine capital and revenue investment and other changes. So it's not just revenue, capital.
No, I don't accept that. Scottish Enterprise Resource has gone from 135 to 141 million, so that's an increase of 6 million, and the Scottish Enterprise Capital Budget is going from 80 to 76, which is a reduction of 4, so it's a net increase of 2 million. The situation in South of Scotland on resource and capital together is an increase of the two together, and Hands and
Islands. I mean, you include financial transaction funding.
Yes, but as I said, financial transactions are a slightly different proposition. But I think the wider point I'd make, however, is the point that the budget has got to be, and I was very candid about this to Parliament and what I said. We're sitting with inflation at 10.5%. The budget's not increased by 10.5%. The budget hasn't even increased by the GDP deflator, hence the real terms reduction from 2021-22. So I can't allocate money that I don't have. And there have been tough choices. What I've tried to do, because I've got multiple pressures, we're in the Economy and Fair Work Committee today, but the Health Committee is probably meeting somewhere else in the building just now, and they'll be looking at the colossal pressures in the health service. So all budgets will be an attempt to deal with financial strain when resources are tight, and that's I've tried to strike the most reasonable balance I can. I'm not going to disguise the fact that organisations face financial challenges. They'll have to change the ways in which they are working. I was explicit about these requirements to Parliament when I set out the budget proposition.
But my question was, before we started debating figures, was how will this impact on support for business? I mean, what direction are you going to give to agencies over how they'll implement what is, you've said, a very challenging financial budget for them?
Well, obviously, we will set out letters of guidance to the boards of the three organisations involved, which will very much reflect the priorities of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. So the agenda will be entirely consistent with the government's wider agenda, and we will look to those organisations to take forward, as they always do, these priorities within the constraints of the resources that we're able to make available to them. Now, that may involve organisations changing the way they work, perhaps moving to more digital propositions. There's obviously scope for greater digital propositions to be used in the delivery services. But fundamentally, as I answered to Fiona Hislop, we want the enterprise agencies to be engaged in working directly with companies to increase and improve their performance.
So will we see a scale back in direct investment for businesses from the agencies?
I don't think that necessarily has to be the case. I think that what I've tried to do is to provide a financial settlement that allows organisations to adapt to what is a much more pressurised environment financially, and for them to adjust their way of working to enable that to be the case.
Maggie Chapman.
Good morning, Deputy First Minister. Thank you for joining us this morning. I want to pick up on a couple of points that we've touched on and expand on them a little bit. In response to questions from Fiona Hislop around tourism, you talked about digital connectivity and the importance of that in the shift in their marketing strategy. I think if we think about digital connectivity more broadly, it's clearly important for local and regional economies. It's important, as we've seen, a shift in working practices, more people working from home. Entrepreneurs often start off at home and therefore require that. Within this budget, we see digital funding being reduced by over 26%, significantly in cash terms compared to last year. And I was just wondering how, in the comments, that you say that this relates to new spending profiles over the life of that programme. Can you elaborate on that and give us a little bit more detail? And I suppose, importantly, what are the impacts on people who've been waiting for connectivity? How is that going to materially affect their ability to be connected?
This principally relates to the completion of the R100 programme, which, as Maggie Chapman, the committee, will know, is a programme that's been taken forward over a number of years and is now operational in all parts of the country. So essentially, the commitment exists to achieve the objectives of the R100 programme, and what we're essentially looking at is the detailed delivery of that year by year, and also it's an approach which takes into account the changing picture of investment made by telecoms companies themselves as they roll out their investment programme into the bargain. And on occasion, and we've seen this in recent years, as changes take place in the technology that's available and the ability of telecoms companies to broaden their network, that reduces the scale of the challenge that's required under the R100 programme. So it's a bit of a combination of those two factors. But I recognise all of the relevant issues that Maggie Chapman raises about the importance of digital connectivity and its centrality for the ability to live and work in a broad range of locations around Scotland. And of course, I think it is important to remember that we've made absolutely colossal strides forward on the availability of that digital connectivity around Scotland.
Okay. Thanks for that response. That's helpful to know. I suppose that the focus or the areas, the geographical areas that are most disconnected in a wide variety of ways are, you know, still those who have yet to see some of this connectivity. And I think there's a real imperative that we get this right. If I can shift to another issue, again following up from one of Fiona Hislop's questions around financing the just transition. We've spoken about skills and the importance of getting that element right. I think there's also something particularly, again, if we're thinking of the Scottish economy and breaking it down into regional and local economies, around supply chains and making sure that we sustain local supply chains. What are the major challenges, other than total sum of budget, that we have, that you see in terms of the financial and investment decisions that regional economy boards, regional economy forums can and are or aren't making around securing sustainable local supply chains?
These will inevitably vary around the country. Mm-hmm. So let me provide the committee with an example of a discussion I had with the Convention of the Highlands and Islands in the autumn of last year, where I've chaired the Convention of the Highlands and Islands on every occasion it has met in the last 15 years since we came to government in 2007. And I have rarely taken part in a more optimistic conversation about economic prospects in the Highlands and Islands. It really was a very, despite all the challenges, a really very buoyant conversation about opportunities. But one of the common themes of concern about the realisation of these economic opportunities was, for example, the availability of housing, mm-hmm. and the availability of people. So, and it wasn't just the availability of affordable housing, it was housing across all different strands of the market, quite simply because of the challenges of delivery in more sparsely populated areas. Mm-hmm. It's a different proposition developing a site, you know, in some of the sites in West Lothian, for example, where there's vast housing expansion being undertaken, compared to sites that might be 10 or 12 houses in a rural part of the Highlands and Islands. So I think the availability of housing and the ability of putting in place specific solutions, and I stress it's not just about the affordable housing programme, it's at other stages in the market, but then also the availability of people. And the availability of people is a challenge in many other parts of the country. And that's down to, the committee will be familiar with the government's concerns about the loss of migration as a consequence of the Brexit process, because we are undoubtedly seeing greater pressure on our labour market as a consequence of the reduction in the number of people who are available. Now, what that emphasises then is the importance of trying to maximise the number of people who are living here, mm-hmm. of enabling them to be economically active. And as I said, I think we are seeing the early signs of progress in that respect, but it represents a fundamental part of the government's policy programme and its budget to do more in that respect, because that will help us to address the issue of child poverty, which exists in our society, and by enabling parents to enter the labour market to ensure there are good economic and employment opportunities for young people in our economy, we can enable people to join the labour market.
Thank you. I know we're verging into NSET discussions, so I'll back to you.
Thank you. We are running towards the end of time here, but if questions and answers could be as concise as possible, I'll get a few more people in. Jamie Harcourt-Johnson to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much indeed. Just a couple of quick questions around kind of tourism and hospitality. As was raised earlier, Scotland's tourism budget has been cut. The Irish tourism budget has gone up by 13 million euros for next year. What impact do you think that has on our competitiveness, with obviously a similar nature, but competitor nature in terms of tourism?
Again, just for the record, the Visit Scotland resource budget has gone from 41.4 million to 41.6 million on resource. So it's increased slightly in cash terms. So that's just for the record. I think Visit Scotland does a fabulous job. I think it's a really successful agency. I think it's well led. I think its marketing propositions are absolutely first class. They're inspiring. They win a whole host of global awards and recognition for their strength, and I think that helps in their competitiveness. I think also
the question was actually about when a competitor nation is increasing its budget for tourism,
Well,
It doesn't necessarily follow that just by spending more money on it that we achieve better results. I don't think that necessarily follows. It's about effectiveness, and I think Visit Scotland's a supremely effective organisation.
Sound at all that as I say, a country that we compete with on the global stage for tourism is increasing its tourism, but you don't think that has an impact?
Well, I can't allocate money I don't have, Mr. Halko Johnson.
Okay.
So I can only do my level best to fulfil the needs of the budget cycle. I've had to increase tax to enable me to meet all the commitments that I'm taking forward. So I've taken some hard decisions to enable us to have the position that we've got. But I've got great confidence in Visit Scotland. The other thing I would say, and this is a really important part of the question, is really to recognise the strength of the investment and commitment made by the tourism sector itself, because Scotland's tourism proposition now is of formidably greater quality because of the investments that have been made by a range of private organisations over many years. And obviously the Scottish National Investment Bank has taken some significant steps to try to assist that. The development out in the outskirts of Edinburgh at Rathall, a major tourism visitor development that's been invested in there by Visit Scotland, which will enable people to develop their surfing skills on the outskirts of Edinburgh, which is a sentence I never thought I'd ever utter, but I've uttered it.
There's a future media opportunity for you, but
maybe for us both.
I don't think anybody wants to see that. But if I can move on very quickly, just to kind of wider issues around kind of tourism and hospitality. I think Colin Smith talked about the business aid relief package that's available in England. There was a lot of disappointment from the tourism and hospitality sector that wasn't available. I think it was about 200 million of Barnett consequentials, but obviously you've decided, as is your right, to put that money kind of elsewhere. We're seeing, although you may dispute it, less money for tourism funding and for some of the enterprise bodies. We're seeing more regulations for the sector, such as deposit return scheme, the short-term licensing. The Scottish Beer and Pub Association, talking at the budget, says it puts Scotland's pubs at a significant disadvantage in their recovery, given the challenge that they're facing. The Scottish Hospitality Group said they welcomed the freeze on business rates, but they said the budget was simply nowhere near enough to see the sector through. There is now a clear differential between England, Wales and hospitality businesses in Scotland. It is a fact that many small businesses won't survive. The Scottish Tourism Alliance, again, welcomed the freeze, but they said 23% of Scottish tourism businesses are in survival mode. So do you recognise those pressures on the sector, and do you think you're doing enough to support them?
Yeah, I absolutely recognise how tough things are out there. I hear it in my constituency caseload. I engage much more widely with the economy, so of course I recognise that. And what I've tried to do is to address the issues that are put to me by a range of organisations. So as I said earlier on, 16 business organisations asked me to freeze the business rates poundage, and I've done that. That doesn't come without a cost. That's estimated to be a saving to taxpayers of about £308 million. About half of retail, hospitality and leisure businesses will be eligible for 100% small business bonus relief, so there's a very big part of the sector will be relieved of that pressure. Obviously, there are we rely upon the United Kingdom government to come forward with some of the issues that are forcing the increase in cost for business, which are the energy costs. That's probably the biggest factor of change in the cost base of businesses, and I do hope that the successor scheme, which will take effect in March, is able to support businesses to the extent that they recognise. And I would point out that for all of the agencies in a very tough budget settlement are actually seeing modest increases in the resources that are available to them. So, in short, I feel as if Within the resources available to me, I've done as much as I can to help out these sectors, but I appreciate that they face tough times.
OK, thank you.
Thank you. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Mayor. Deputy First Minister, I'd like to just pick up on a couple of cuts and get your comments on what the impact of these is. Cities investment and strategy funding is reduced by 12.5%. and the regeneration programme's budget by 20.9%. I guess both of these reflect the changing spend profiles of programmes and projects, but can you perhaps say a little bit more about what the impact of these reductions in spending will be?
Well, essentially, what this involves is us responding to the profile of the range of, if I use the summary title of city deals or growth deals, because they obviously span a number of years. I think the shortest is 10 years, the longest is 20 is the longest. So there's quite a variation in the financial commitments over those years. And as projects come forward, they will have varying demands on the public purse. There's also, some of these projects will be facing some of the issues that we're wrestling with in our wider capital budget, which are around the cost of some of these propositions because of the increase in input prices. So that may be creating some challenges about the timescales around projects, because if the cost is rising because of rising input prices, there may be an argument for developing a proposition at a later stage. So I think what I'd assure the committee about is that there is the commitment to these schemes remains in place, and obviously we're supporting the delivery of these in concert with a range of local authorities around the country to reflect the varying timescales that are put to us.
Can I just ask about the international trade and investment spending, which has seen an increase of 11.2%. The government has a target to increase international exports by 25% towards the end of the decade. I think the document that directs this was published in 2019, and I think within priority one markets, whereas the European Union, obviously the relationship there has changed. So if the Cabinet Secretary is able to give an update on what the increased spending is hoping to achieve, and if we are going to see a refreshment in the export strategy.
The increase in expenditure is designed to support the increased international activity of the Scottish economy, and to ensure that we are able to assist companies in that activity. Obviously, that becomes more challenging because of what's happened around about Brexit, which I think should ensure that, which highlights the importance of us supporting that activity to enable companies to be able to trade internationally. In terms of the strategy, we obviously will periodically review the focus and the emphasis of the strategy. Is very much the agenda that Ivan McKee takes forward on the government's behalf, and certainly we have no immediate plans to revise that strategy, but we do keep it under review, and if there are any updates, we can certainly share those with the committee.
Thank you. And just a final question on consolidated accounts, which the Audit Committee think are looking at the moment. The 2021-22 account did show an underspend of £536 million in finance and economy budget. I suppose at the moment, in December, we will know the consolidated accounts for the year that we are currently in. But there have been a number of areas. Now, I mentioned employability, Ms Huslop has mentioned Visit Scotland, where if money was to be available, there could be, we believe, small amounts of money could make quite a big difference. Is there any expectation that there will be flexibility in the coming budget as we move into the 23-24 period?
Well, you alight on perhaps my greatest worry issue just now, convener. As I said earlier on, as I chaired with the Finance Committee last week. Currently, my estimation of the financial of the overspend on resource budgets is in a range between £200 and £500 million, and the variability there is about what is my assessment of the likely financial performance of a lot of organisations and whether they can come in on budget. So my focus just now is on trying to reduce that number. So some of the figures that you put to me, convener, are often, and we go through these arguments in Parliament, particularly with the provisional outturns statement that Tom Arthur delivers, and then also in the publication of the consolidated accounts, that some of the underspends don't translate into resources the government can actually spend. So, for example, there's a large underspend last year on student loans funding, which we can't spend on other priorities. It's ring-fenced annual managed expenditure. So my priority is to try to get the budget into balance between now and the end of March. I'm here in a temporary capacity. In my 9 years as finance minister, there is no way I was dealing with a likely overspend of this magnitude in the middle of January in any financial year. It would be well settled by this time. So I'm acutely anxious about that position. Now, obviously, if we are able to constrain spending between now and the end of the year, or if there is something that comes our way from the supplementary estimates of the United Kingdom government, which we don't yet have sight of those, we expect to have those, I would think, within the next 4 to 6 weeks, then the position might change and there may be some resources to carry forward. But this is the first year the government has set a budget without anticipating carrying forward any resources from this year into next year.
Okay, thank you. That brings us to the end of this evidence session. I will briefly suspend the meeting before we start the next session. So our next item of business is an evidence session on the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. We did previously take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy in March 2022 when the report was published, and in October 2022 the Scottish Government published the delivery plans. I will ask members and witnesses to be as concise as possible. A number of issues have previously been discussed in the budget session, so if questions could be targeted, that would be helpful. If I could just maybe start by, this is the first session we've had since the delivery plans have been published, and it is a long-term strategy, so this is an opportunity for the committee to start to set out ways in which we will look to scrutinise development of the strategy. There was mixed report, it's fair to say, in March when it was published. I think Tom Farmer said it was a wish list, and Ros Foy had some critical comments about missed opportunities. But I would hope that the publication of the delivery plans has maybe given people more engagement and some confidence in the way forward. But can I ask how this strategy will be different from previous strategies? We have, since the Parliament was created, had a number of economic strategies. Productivity in Scotland is still slower than our European counterparts. Our economic growth isn't as high as we would like it to be. What is different about this 10-year strategy that will see a step change in Scotland's economy?
I think what the national strategy is designed to do, and I suppose the objective of it is consistent with other previous ventures, is to give a very clear distillation of the government's agenda and what we are looking to a variety of different organisations who contribute to the economic direction of Scotland to do to ensure that we can realise that those ambitions. So the strategy has got a focus on a range of major themes around entrepreneurship, around market opportunities, around the regional dimension of economic policy, around skills, around the creation of a fairer and a more equal society, and crucially around the concept of delivery, of making sure that we turn the aspirations into practical reality. I think the key focus about the strategy, which is perhaps different, is that it comes at a moment when our economy has to make a substantial change in its profile and its focus towards net zero. It has to do that. And in a sense, I suppose, if you look back on strategies over the last 10, 20 years, there wasn't that imperative to actually change the focus of the economy. And I think what the document and the delivery plans helpfully assist in doing is giving a clear idea about how the government intends to do that and how we intend to engage organisations in that endeavour.
Thank you. I'll bring in Graeme Simpson to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thanks very much, convener. We had the chief entrepreneur, Mark Logan, in front of us last week. I raised the issue of his rather large salary, £200,000 for 2 days a week, and he mounted what I would describe as the L'Oreal defence, because I'm worth it. Now, how would you assess whether he's worth it or not? What sort of progress are you looking for from Mr. Logan? How's his role going to be measured? And how's it going to be assessed?
The first thing is that I think we're very lucky to have the skills and the capability of Mark Logan available to the government. He is a formidable private sector player who's delivered significant economic opportunities and gains as a consequence of his judgments and decision-making. So I think those are skills and attributes that I think we're very lucky to have at our disposal, to be honest. I think also the nature of the expertise that Mark Logan has, both at a technology level, but also, if I might say, in a way of operating level, are skills that will be particularly relevant for the transition the Scottish economy has got to make in the period going forward. Because, and why I say it like that is that there's a, there's obviously, Mark Logan has colossal a technology expertise, but he's also delivered very successful projects and propositions. And in the response I just gave to the convener on the challenge that we face in our economy of adapting to net zero, that involves a significant amount of transition within the economy. So having the skills of Mark Logan available to us to help us in that endeavour is important. Obviously, we need to see the fruits of that activity, and we'll see that through the monitoring of the performance of the Scottish economy and the measures that we take forward to ensure that we realise the ambitions that are set out within the national strategy.
With respect, that doesn't quite answer the question. What is it you're specifically looking for out of this role? Are there specific, has it been set targets, for example?
Well, what we want to benefit from is the expertise that Mark Logan can bring to enhance to help us in meeting the challenges that I've just set out. Those challenges of ensuring we realise the technology capabilities and opportunities that are available to us, and secondly, that he assists us in advising about how we make the transition within the Scottish economy to net zero through the encouragement and enhancement of greater entrepreneurial activity within our economy.
Okay, so let me put it this way then. If this committee, sorry, Mr. Cook, are you wanting in?
It's okay, you can.
Right, okay. So if this committee is looking at this particular role, what kind of things should we be looking at for Mr. Logan to deliver?
I think you should be looking to Mr. Logan to deliver progress on the shift to greater technology opportunities within the Scottish economy, and you should be looking to Mr. Logan to contribute towards the encouragement and expansion of entrepreneurial activity within the Scottish economy, some of which is relevant to the points we discussed earlier around the Anna Stewart Review, for example, and other questions.
Okay. Now, aside from the £200,000 that I mentioned, which is paid to a company, has he been given any other resources to fulfil the role?
He has some limited staff support that work with him to assist him in the work, just to arrange the the practical interaction of his engagement with either within government or within the tech or the entrepreneurial community within Scotland.
Okay, I've got one final question, because I asked him last week about his involvement with the company I mentioned earlier, Travelnest. He's still listed as a director of that company, though he told us he'd pulled back some. So maybe he has pulled back, but it struck me that not just for him, but for anyone in a similar role with government, whether they're paid or not, that we should have clarity on their business interests, either as directors or whether they hold shares in particular companies. Is that something you'd agree with?
Yeah, I very much agree with that. And I think if Mark Logan has, I saw the comments he put on the record about his involvement in the company, so I assume that to be correct. But there should be transparency on these points. And if I look at organisations, let's take any of our public bodies, Scottish Enterprise or Hans Hans Enterprise or South of Scotland Enterprise, their directors will have publicly declarable registers of interest. Now, I think so all of that should be done transparently. The point I'd make, which is slightly different point here, is that I don't view it as inappropriate for people in these roles to have wider involvement and activity, because if they didn't, they actually wouldn't be bringing as much to, they wouldn't be bringing as much experience and expertise to the work that we're actually trying to bring them into. So it's almost a catch-22 situation there. But the way of managing that is to have transparent declaration about these things.
So that's something that would have to be set up.
I'll take that point away. Like, I think, you know, I accept the points that Mr. Simpson is making. I think there should be transparency over these questions. If there's any issues that need to be addressed there, I'll address them.
Thank you. There was a chief business advisor role created and appointed in the past week. How does that work together with the chief entrepreneur? And
it just Ellis Watson is providing specific advice to the First Minister to enable the government's engagement with the business community. It's a slightly different type of role to the one that Mark Logan is undertaking. It's essentially about making sure that the government is able to hear and engage with the wider business community directly to the First Minister by utilising the skills of Ellis Watson.
Okay, thank you. That is also the role of ministers, to be doing that with the First Minister.
And we do it.
Colin Smith, Fiona Hislop, to be followed by Colin Smith.
We had a very inspiring and refreshing session with the chief entrepreneur last week. Is very formidable indeed. So to what extent will he have a remit that allows him to engage with other government departments and also with public bodies? And specifically, he raised the issue of intellectual property ownership in universities and how that might preclude entrepreneurship. But clearly, the Funding Council, for example, might want to reward and stimulate startups from universities, and that might be a bit of a conflict. But so what kind of, range and role does he have with public bodies and governments?
There's two distinct questions in the points raised by Fiona Hislop. On the first, in terms of the range of the chief entrepreneur, I basically want to make sure that he's got the widest possible scope within government to try to help us to improve the technological transformation of government, for example, making sure that our ways of working are as efficient as they possibly can be. So I talk to Mark Logan on a regular basis and benefit from his thinking. And obviously I'm doing a lot of work on public sector reform. It'll be essential in relation to the realisation of the budget. So there'll be ever more involvement. So I want to see that at the broadest possible range. On the second question around intellectual property, I think our universities are slightly more relaxed about these questions than they used to be, and that doesn't mean to say that we're in a perfect position. Obviously, intellectual property is a formidable asset in some circumstances. Some startups that have emerged from universities have generated enormous economic benefit because they've been such good developments. And part of what Mark Logan is trying to do is to encourage more of that and to encourage more of that university research business dialogue. But if I look at universities now, I look at some of the arrangements they have in place. I was in Glasgow University just a few weeks ago at the Mazumba Shaw Advanced Research Centre, which is a fabulous investment. It's the result of a significant financial donation by Keir Mazumba Shaw and her late husband John Shaw, which in partnership with the University of Glasgow is developing a really exciting research collaborative environment which other universities will have such facilities. The University of Edinburgh has the Bayes Centre, which is modelled on a similar type of concept. So these meeting points, if I could call them that, are a great forum for the development of these research propositions, which I think we could be optimistic will generate significant and productive benefits for the Scottish economy.
And of course, universities are independent institutions, but it depends what the funding council as funders might do, I suppose. And I think, are we open to just think about things where we come across? And that's a repeated challenge we've heard.
I think there's also a question here, and this is where I suppose I appeal to the sense of community of our universities, that there is a role for the universities to recognise that some of that intellectual property might have a wider societal benefit and a wider commercial benefit for the Scottish economy. And I just would encourage our universities to be open to that proposition. So obviously, as Mrs. Locke correctly says, an interaction with the funding council and the allocation of research resources. But I think the more we all work collaboratively in this endeavour, and Mark Logan is in place to try to assist us in doing that to a greater extent possible, then we will be able to see the benefits of all of that.
And I just want to move on now to the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan. You've been very generous with your time, so a short answer will suffice. Is this on course to be published in 2023 as per the delivery plan of NZET? And how will the refresh interact with the ongoing review of Scotland's skills landscape that's being led by James Withers?
The Climate Skills Action Plan will be published as scheduled. And obviously, if there are any issues or implications that emerge from the James Withers review, we will take those into account in the aftermath of the publication of the Climate Skills Action Plan. But I do recognise the necessity of us proceeding with the publication of that document.
Thank you.
Thank you. Colin Smith, be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Just to follow up on that question, Deputy First Minister, it's widely recognised that the increase in renewables, in particular onshore wind, has cut emissions, but it hasn't delivered those huge potential economic benefits that we envisage, particularly around jobs. It was a point that the STUC made in response to the strategy. Now, when you were last Cabinet Secretary for Finance, and I think it was then called Sustainable Growth, we were promised there would be 130,000 renewable jobs per year by 2020. Well, the government doesn't record renewable jobs, but a recent report by the Fraser Vander Institute estimates that actual number is just 27,000 per year. So does the government currently have a target for renewable jobs that this strategy will help deliver?
We don't have a target in that respect, but I think the focus of our agenda is about maximising the economic opportunities for Scotland from the renewables revolution that is going to take place. And we've obviously got significant opportunities arising out of the ScotWind process, the opportunities that we hope will come out of carbon capture, the opportunities that will come out of hydrogen that will enable us to realise significant economic opportunities. And that will obviously link very directly to the work we have to do on the just transition, to recognise the need for the transition, particularly in the northeast of Scotland, around about the oil and gas sector.
How do we measure that? Because at the moment, most of the onshore wind turbines we see capping across our landscape, they're not built here in Scotland. So how do we really assess whether or not we're actually reaching that potential? Because renewable jobs will increase because of the work that's taking place, but how do we assess whether or not that is really delivering the scale of the potential that is clearly out there?
We'll obviously see it from the, you know, we have a significant amount of data that's available on the labour market. I've gone through quite a lot of that data this morning. We're able to see at a sector level what employment levels are. We're able to see the gross value added that will come from particular employment, and clearly that flows into the productive capacity of the Scottish economy. So that, you know, I think the data sets are available for us to be able to see all of that information and to make a judgment about how much has been realised within Scotland. I think it will also be clear from the implications for supply chains about the extent to which we are seeing the turning of these projects into economic reality on the ground within Scotland.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson to be followed by Jamie Hockwell-Johnson.
Hello again. I'm going to ask some more questions about women entrepreneurs, if that's okay. Again, you know, when the NZ was put out, I can see there's a number of worthwhile initiatives, and the thrust of it, we all, you know, who wouldn't buy into that? But I wanted to explore a bit more as you start to get into specific projects, how you are going to be able to ensure that female entrepreneurs are absolutely at the heart of the strategy. And therefore, when you develop your key performance indicators, whatever success measures you have, that they are very, very specific. So, for example, in development to begin under Project 1, increase the number of talented early stage company founders, increase the number and diversity of entrepreneurs. Now, I'm not asking you to answer that question just now, but I would personally want to know, for female entrepreneurs, for female early stage startups, from what to what? So my question is, will you be able to do that? Do you plan to do that as you put the detailed development? And secondly, are you able to commit to make the targets bold, audacious, ambitious, and frankly frightening in terms of moving the dial of female entrepreneurs and their contribution?
I think on the last part of Michelle Thompson's question, yes, I think we should have bold ambitions here, because I think we have got, we are not realising the potential of the Scottish economy and Scottish society because of the fact that we have such a difference in the level of participation in entrepreneurship between women and men. So, yes, we have to confront this issue, which is why we've commissioned Anna Stewart to undertake an independent review on this question. And from that will flow the specific interventions we have to take to address the ambitions that Michelle Thompson puts to me. So what I would say is that I would want to ensure that our the steps we take on in response to Anna Stewart's review are commensurate with realising the ambitions that Michelle Thompson puts to me.
Well, that's good to hear, and you can be fully confident that I will be back asking
how specifically
they are bold, and ambitious.
And I think on this question, recognising its significance, ministers should come back to the committee to explain in greater detail where we're heading as a consequence of that activity.
And going back to my earlier point in the earlier session about data, as the individual projects are planned out, I will want to see specific data categories for the percentage increase or numerical increase of female entrepreneurs in each of those. I mean, there's various projects set out, but I will be asking to see that so that I can make my own assessment as to how bold numbers.
And we should be able to disaggregate that data to enable all of that analysis to be undertaken.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Jamie Howcroft-Johnson, be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much. For a couple of very short questions. Obviously, we want to attract people to set up their businesses in Scotland. We want to attract entrepreneurship. What analysis or what advice have you had on the potential impact that if an individual is looking to set up in Scotland, they're likely to pay higher income tax than they would do in other parts of the United Kingdom?
Obviously, this is an issue which is considered by the Scottish Fiscal Commission in looking at tax propositions that we put forward, and obviously from that we can deduce the impact of measures in relation to expectations of behavioural change as a consequence. So that advice is available from the Fiscal Commission. It informs ultimately the expectations of revenue to be raised that are included in the budget proposition. I think what there will of course be a wide variety of considerations that any individual will make about the choice of their location as to where to live and work based on a variety of different factors. And obviously, we have a very different proposition, as I set out to Parliament, about the social contract that's available to people in Scotland, regardless of their income. And there are, of course, very many different questions around the quality of life and quality of location, which will be relevant in the decisions that people will make.
Thanks, Rachel. Just on that point, have you taken any advice or have there been any input from the chief entrepreneur on that, on potential, their thoughts on...
I've not discussed it as an issue with the chief entrepreneur, no, but I'm very happy to do so.
Okay, thanks. Just the last one. The the NSET Delivery Board was established in May 2020. When was the last meeting of that?
The last meeting of it, I just can't quite think what the date was, but it would be in the autumn.
In December.
December. Yeah, when will the minutes of that be available, or are they available? Does there need to be anything on the Scottish Government website?
Yes, the minutes. The minutes are published on the website, and there's a meeting. The next meeting is before the end of this month as well.
So the next meeting is?
Before the end of this month.
So the minutes will be available on them before that meeting takes place?
Yeah, so there's a website webpage on the delivery board.
Yeah, okay. I couldn't see anything about the minutes on there.
Okay,
so
I'll check.
All right, thank you.
Sorry, I'm in a blank. Who did I say was after? Sorry, Gordon MacDonald, be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, convener. I wanted to ask you about support for business startups, and in particular the new network of tech scaler hubs set up via Codebase. I realise, you know, the announcement was only July and it was only launched in November, but what will be the measure of success of those? How will we know whether it's been a successful venture or not?
Obviously, we'll, I suspect, responding to Michelle Thompson's questions, there'll be data sets that will emerge about the number of ventures that have been supported and the progress that's been made in relation to employment levels, gross value added, the impact in terms of technology ventures that have emerged and what is their journey, because the aspiration of the Tech Scaler programme is to encourage, yes, early start development, but then also to build on that, to ensure that companies are able to make the journey from startups to scale up. So I think the data will enable us to explore the effectiveness and success of this venture. I think what I would be very confident about is that Codebase have got the attributes to enable us to be able to realise our aspirations from this programme, given the formidable track record they've got here in the City of Edinburgh.
The seven tech scalers are mostly in Scotland cities, although I notice there aren't any in either Perth or our new city of Dunfermline. But is there if they prove to be the success that we're hoping for, will it be rolled out in other areas of Scotland, including rural Scotland?
I certainly, I would remain open to these questions, but I think the way that the model is designed, and given the significant dependence on technology capabilities, I don't think location should be in any way a barrier to people benefiting from the resources of the tech scalers. I think there's also an important question which arises, which is about the ability of other bodies and institutions to support this direction of travel. So our universities and colleges, for which we've got a very extensive network of their premises right throughout the country, are able to play a part in working with the tech scalers and ensuring that some of the attributes of the tech scalers can be used more broadly around the country.
And this model of hubs, is it something that could be used in other sectors, non-tech sectors?
I think Yes, without a doubt. But I think what the Tech Scalers programme recognises is the specific opportunity and necessity of making progress on the question of tech activity to ensure that we realise those benefits for the Scottish economy.
Okay, thanks so much.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, Claire. I'm interested in exploring a couple of issues. You've spoken before about the purpose, what the economy is for, and you state very, very clearly in various documents that it's to ensure that we serve people and planet effectively now and into the future. And that's, well, the well-being economy is clearly at the heart of the strategy. It's, I suppose, one of the challenges we have is that the economic strategy actually links into so many other elements of governmental work. And I'm interested to know how you think we could improve alignment across all these different strategies, and where are the challenges around policy coherence? Because I think we could argue that there are some things that we do in one area that maybe counter or jeopardise some of the ambitions in other areas of governmental work.
I would want to hope that was not the case, because there should be alignment in government policy. Indeed, I spend a lot of my role as Deputy First Minister is spent ensuring, you know, I have responsibility for the delivery of the government's programmes. So a lot of my time is spent making sure that we do have policy alignment, that we have, you know, we do not have incompatibilities in our policy programme, and that we essentially work to ensure there is a cohesive a thread that runs through all of government policy. So that's something that I recognise as important in the delivery of government. And I think what the budget certainly was trying to do, and what the budget was, if you look at the thread that runs between the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, the programme for government in September, the budget in December, and the kind of wider direction of government policy, I would like to, the other element to that is the Child Poverty Delivery Plan, which was published earlier last year. If you look at the thread running through all of those, I would argue there is policy alignment. It's reflected also in the energy strategy that Michael Matheson published just last week. So there's a, I think that question of alignment is critical. If there are areas that concern members about alignment, then obviously I will listen carefully to them to ensure that we do have that that thread running through all of policy.
Okay, just a little bit further on that before I move on. I suppose some of the challenges around, I mean, you talked about house building earlier, and there are obviously going to be negative impacts, whether they are environmental impacts or other impacts on construction, which can be mitigated and can be balanced out with other mechanisms. And I'm just wondering, I suppose maybe it is your assertion that we have those balancing mechanisms right or effective. I suppose what is the ongoing monitoring to ensure that we do actually have these issues covered off, so we can ensure not only the policy coherence, but actually that we've got our assessment of that coherence correct.
I think going back to the budget, you know, there's three themes that I concentrated on in setting out the budget. One was about the elimination of child poverty. The second was about sustainable public services. The third was about the economic transition to net zero. So in a sense, that to me provides, that gives the best distillation of the policy framework in which we are operating, where there is an absolute necessity to make the journey to net zero and to achieve that. And we obviously have regular assessments of our performance in so doing, and we're on the receiving end of a particularly challenging recent one from the Committee on Climate Change about the effectiveness of our current arrangements, and the plans the government is bringing forward are designed at this moment to try to advance that agenda to the greatest extent we possibly can do. So I think the challenge that Maggie Chapman puts to me is one that I acknowledge and accept, but I think it's best reflected in how we take forward the wider policy agenda that to which I referred.
Okay. Thank you. My last question is around community wellbeing and social enterprises and the value of alternative economic models being crucial to that resilient, sustainable, prosperous economy that you've spoken about. Can you give us any more information about what you're doing to explore an enhanced role for social enterprises in our economy, given the local and regional benefits that they have over and above other models of enterprise potentially?
The first thing I'd want to say is that I very much associate myself with the aspiration that Maggie Chapman puts to me of the importance of encouraging a vibrant social enterprise sector, and I think it represents a significant opportunity to contribute to the Scottish economy and the creation of meaningful opportunities. There's a long track record of social enterprise activity in Scotland. The cooperative movement globally was founded in Scotland. I had the privilege, as did Fiona Hislop, of working for Mutual Life Assurance Societies, which deployed the mutual principles, which are formidable principles of common ownership within our society. I wish, frankly, we had more of them just now. I think we'd be better served by them if we had more mutual societies. And then social enterprises are the 21st century equivalent. So I think that track record's important. I think in how we support those, I think there's probably three things I would draw on that I think we need to be mindful of. The first is the community wealth building agenda that Tom Arthur takes forward, and for which there's been some outstanding work undertaken by North Ayrshire Council, and we are now trying to apply that more widely. Secondly, there is procurement. I think, you know, we, as a public sector, we procure significantly from the business sector in Scotland. I think procuring a lot of our social care from social enterprises would be a good step forward, frankly. Enabling companies to be able to participate through the procurement system, and I appreciate that isn't always some of the gateway access points on procurement can be an impediment for social enterprises, so we're trying to tackle those. And the third is that our business development network has got to support the development of social enterprises. So social enterprises are businesses. They are not a kind of, you know, a charitable sector away off here in the corner. They are businesses. And our business organisations, to their credit, and you know, all of the South of Scotland Enterprise, Hans Hans Enterprise and Scottish Enterprise, provide business advice to social enterprises, and I very much welcome that.
I'm sure you weren't suggesting that charitable enterprises should be away off in the corner. I think many of them
maybe my turn of phrase wasn't well chosen there, but the point I was making was that they should be on the radar of our enterprise agencies and not thought of to be somebody else's consideration. If I can,
yes, thank you.
Grateful to have had the opportunity to set out my thinking more clearly.
Thank you, Mira. Deputy First Minister, in the light of the pressures surrounding public sector pay and the ongoing threat of industrial action, how do you assess the success so far of prioritising wage increases over spending on employability?
I think actually the experience I think speaks for itself. I think industrial action is enormously disruptive to the operation of our economy and society. So minimising industrial action by resolving industrial disputes for me is a very, very high priority. So we obviously regret the fact that we have had some industrial relations difficulties, that we've had some disputes that have led to strike action. We try to minimise that. We're going to extraordinary lengths to try to be available and accessible to trade unions to try to resolve these issues. Indeed, the Health Secretary and I will be engaged in this question again in the course of this week. So I think the difficulties created by the lack of expansion of employability programmes for me are not as great as the disruption that could come from industrial action had we not resolved the issues that we have resolved.
Just a moment, something slightly different. The Scottish Government's indicated that progress towards a well-being economy is a core principle guiding NSET and other government strategies. How aligned are these strategies currently, and what areas of improvement can you identify that may need to be addressed in the future?
We aim to secure that alignment through the relationship of all these strategies towards the realisation of the ambitions in the National Performance Framework. So the National Performance Framework, which has been the subject of extensive consultation and dialogue with Parliament and stakeholders, is designed to provide a sense of direction, a set of objectives for us to reach and to realise in all of our activity. And I suppose, going back to the answers I gave to Maggie Chapman, I would like to think that we are aligned to support those objectives. I think we've got to be open to challenge on this question. I do spend a lot of my time trying to make sure that we have that alignment. And if colleagues believe that we don't have that right, then I think the government should be open to responding to where that might be the case. A classic example of it is in relation to some of the dilemmas that we've had to wrestle with in relation to the energy strategy and the use of resources and the generation of economic opportunities. And we have tried to reconcile those to the best of our ability within the energy policy framework. And that's, I think, a very good example of how we've tried to do that.
I suppose an obvious question is to ask how we evidence that we have alignment. How do we know? I mean, we may have it in policy, we may have it in all the documents and so on, but how do we actually evidence that?
See it in the data that informs the material on the National Performance Framework. So providing the National Performance Framework is delivering the right sort of strategic perspective across the whole of economy and society. If we have that correct, and obviously again I stress that's something that's been consulted upon by government and Parliament has been extensively engaged in that endeavour, if we assume we've got that correct, we should see that in the data that emerges in that process.
Are there any areas that you know of where more work has to be done?
One of the big lessons I've learned in my time in government is that, and I think probably a very good example of this, is the Child Poverty Delivery Plan. If you do not look comprehensively at what every area of government can contribute to a policy objective, if you just think, well, we tackle child poverty by increasing benefit payments, let me simplify it to that level. If you took that view, I don't think you would have a particularly effective anti-child poverty strategy, because you would be missing out on the whole range of different interventions that government can make and different organisations can make to support that objective. So when we formulated the Child Poverty Delivery Plan, we actively challenged different areas of government about the way they were working, how they were interacting with people who were living in poverty, what more support they could put in place to assist people living in poverty to enable us to achieve those wider objectives. And that, to me, represents some of the challenge that exists. Now, off the top of my head, I can't think of an area where I think we need to do more in that respect, but obviously if there are issues on the minds of members of the committee, I'd be happy to listen to those.
Thank you. Just a couple of quick questions, one probably more expansive than the other. The first one is around Programme 4, which is skilled workforce. There have in recent years been a number of reports, including Lowe's Enterprise and Skills Review, and you know, that's supposed to be implemented. There has been the Audit Scotland report that was critical of relationships between Scottish Funding Council and others. We now have a James Withers review being undertaken into skills. It is the one issue that every industrial business panel that comes before us says they don't have the right skills and the right people in the right place. When will people stop telling us that, committee? I mean, it consistently comes up as one of the key issues for all sectors, from tourism through to renewables, through to, I mean, just every sector talks about their frustration at the skills landscape.
The key thing here, I've wrestled with this question for quite some time in different responsibilities, and I think the key thing that can help us to resolve these questions is the quality of dialogue that exists between business and those responsible for the development of skills. So whether that's individual, I cited that example of the in Ayrshire, where it's exactly what should happen. A business wants to get off the ground, wants to develop an opportunity, they want to have skilled personnel, they can't find them, and they go to a college and the college says this is what we'll do, and they get it all underway and we make progress. There can be a lot of work done, a lot of elaboration done on the formulation of skills action plans and skills audits. You know, Skills Development Scotland have led a really good piece of work in different localities, looking at skills development plans to make sure that, because these issues are invariably resolved in localities, because people don't, you know, the level of geographic mobility in the country is relatively limited. So we have to resolve these issues in localities, and that's about making sure that the quality of dialogue between business and providers is at the highest level possible.
Okay. And the role of this committee is to scrutinise the delivery plans and the 10-year strategy. I think the Culture of Delivery programme does say an annual progress report would be published. Are you able to say when the first one is due to be?
I would expect the first report to be published during the course of this calendar year. Obviously, the strategy was set out in about May, if my memory serves me right. March.
August?
Yeah, so I suspect it will be. The other plans were published in October. So I suspect we'll be, you know, we'll make a judgment about that, but it'll be during this calendar year. I think the other thing I'd say...
I hope it'd be during the calendar year, that would be a year's annual report, but when you're in a position tell the committee a clearer idea, if it would be at least seasonal, it would be looking at, you know, summer to autumn.
I think also, convener, if the committee... I've been very struck by some of the questions that have been put to me this morning, without wishing to single out to Michelle Thompson, but about particular areas of interest. So if the committee has got particular aspirations about the information that we'd like to see, detail it would like to have available to it, I would willingly consider how we can most positively respond to that if we can.
Okay, thank you. And Jamie Huckle-Johnson, do you have a question that's a point of clarification?
Yes, it was just regards to the question I asked earlier about the NSET Delivery Board. I checked back because I'm always kind of conscious that these things could be my issue rather than anybody else, but I couldn't see any minutes on that, and I couldn't see a date of the next meeting. So can we make sure that that obviously is updated as it was? And I also had a question on the investor panel. I think that was meant to meet on the 12th of December. Did that meeting take place? If so, when would minutes be available for that? When will it next meet?
On the NSET board, you know, the board has met. It's met, I think, since I took over interim responsibilities, it's met on, I think, at least two occasions, if my memory serves me right, and there is another meeting coming up, because I've got preparatory discussions for that tomorrow, I think. And so we'll make sure, but you know, Mr. Huckle-Johnson is absolutely correct. Minutes should be published, and if they're not up there, then I apologise for that, and we'll rectify that as soon as we possibly can do. In relation to the investor panel, it met in December. I'm not sure when the next meeting is, but Richard can help me there.
There's a couple more meetings of the panel between now and the summer. after which it will make recommendations to the First Minister.
And when would we receive the meeting? The minute, when would the minutes be available for the for the?
I'll double check and make sure they're put up as soon as possible.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. That brings us to the end of the evidence session this morning. Thank you to the Deputy First Minister and his officials for joining us and for the evidence we've heard. I will now move into private session.